Welcome to a video on the derivative of the sine and cosine functions. The derivative of sine x is equal to cosine x, and the derivative of cosine x is equal to negative sine x. Let's take a look at a proof of this first derivative. If we apply the limit definition of the derivative, we would have the limit as h approaches 0 of this quotient. Now, if we use the sum identity for sine, as we see here, we could expand this term to the sum of these products. Next, if we take this first term and this term and factor out sine x, we would have cosine h minus 1 divided by h. Then if we took the second term and factored out cosine x, we'd be left with sine h divided by h. Next, when we find this limit, we end up getting those two special limits that we just discussed in a previous video, where we know that this limit is equal to 0, and this limit is equal to 1. So we have negative sine x times 0 plus cosine x times 1, which gives us a derivative of sine x as cosine x. Let's take a look at this graphically as well. Here we have the graph of sine x, and then we have this blue tangent line. What we're going to do is plot the slopes of these tangent lines over here to form the graph of the derivative of sine x. So it looks like here our slope is equal to approximately 1. At the top of this relative maximum, we have a slope of 0. Notice how we plotted a point on the x-axis here, and so on. So again, we're plotting the slopes of the tangent lines on the right to form the derivative function. And we can see that the derivative of the graph of sine x forms the function f prime of x equals cosine x. So the derivative of the sine function is equal to the cosine function. Let's do the same for cosine x. So again, we're going to graph the derivative on the right, or the slopes of the tangent lines, to form the derivative function of y equals cosine x. As you can see, the slopes are negative, so we're plotting points below the x-axis. It's returning, the slope is now 0, then it's turning positive, back to 0, turning negative, back to 0, and positive again. And what we'll notice here, the derivative of the cosine function graphed here is actually the sine function reflected across the x-axis, or f prime of x is equal to negative sine x. Now, of course, this is not a proof, but you may want to try to prove that yourself using a similar method that we did proving the derivative of sine x. Let's go ahead and apply these two derivative formulas with some problems. We want to find the derivative of each function here. So f prime of x is equal to the derivative of x cubed. Using the power rule, we'd have 3x squared minus 1 half times the derivative of cosine. Well, the derivative of cosine is negative sine x. So we need to simplify this. So we'd have 3x squared plus 1 half sine x. For this next one, we cannot apply the power rule in this form. Let's go ahead and rewrite this as x to the power of negative 1 minus 3 sine x. So now we can find g prime of x. That'll be equal to negative 1 times x to the negative 1 minus 1, that's negative 2 power, minus 3 times the derivative of sine x, which is cosine x. Now we need to clean this up a little bit. So this would be negative 1 over x squared minus 3 cosine x. Let's take a look at a few more examples. H prime of x will be equal to 2 times the derivative of sine x, which is cosine x, plus 3 times the derivative of cosine x, which is negative sine x. So we've got to watch the signs when we find these derivatives. Let's go ahead and rewrite this as 2 cosine x minus 3 sine x. And one more basic derivative here. Let's rewrite this as x to the 1 half power. Now we'll go ahead and apply the power rule to find the derivative of this first term. So we'll have 4 times 1 half x to the 1 half minus 1, that'd be negative 1 half, plus 3 times the derivative of cosine x, which is negative sine x. Let's go ahead and clean this up. It's like we'll have 2, and this would become the square root of x in the denominator. Moving this down, it would be x to the 1 half, which is the square root of x, and then minus 3 sine x. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look at one more problem that's a little more involved. We want to determine the points where the function has horizontal tangent lines on the interval from 0 to 2 pi. Remember, the derivative would be equal to 0 where we have horizontal tangent lines. So we need to find the derivative, set it equal to 0, and then solve for x. So f prime of x is equal to, this is the square root of 3 times x to the first. So the derivative of x to the first would just be 1. So we have the square root of 3. And the derivative of cosine x is negative sine x. We want to know where this is equal to 0. So what we'll do here is clean it up and then solve for sine x. Add 2 sine x to both sides. Divide by 2. So we need to find the angles where the sine function value is equal to square root 3 over 2. This should remind you of a 30, 60, 90 right triangle, where a 60 degree angle has a sine function value of square root 3 over 2. However, the sine function is also positive in the second quadrant, so we need to sketch a 60 degree reference angle in the first and the second quadrant to determine both angles that have a sine function value of square root 3 over 2. So x will equal 60 degrees or pi over 3 radians. X could also equal 120 degrees or 2 pi divided by 3 radians. Now, it's asking for the points where the function has a horizontal tangent line. So we only found the x coordinates. So we do have to still go back and find the y coordinates of those points. The way we do that is take these x values, sub them back into the original function to find the corresponding y values. Let's take this information over to the next screen. So when x is equal to pi over 3, f of x will equal square root 3 times pi over 3 plus 2 cosine pi over 3. So using the reference triangle in the first quadrant, the cosine of pi over 3 is going to equal 1 half. So we'll have square root 3 pi divided by 3 plus 2 times 1 half, which is equal to 1. And 1 is the same as 3 thirds. So we'd have the square root 3 pi plus 3 all over 3 for the y coordinate. So that point is going to be pi over 3, square root 3 pi plus 3 all over 3. Next, when x is equal to 2 pi over 3, we'll use the reference triangle in the second quadrant to find f of x. And the only difference here is now that cosine 2 pi over 3 is going to be negative 1 half. So we'll have 2 square root 3 pi over 3 plus 2 times negative 1 half. So instead of having a plus 3 here, we'll have a minus 3. So the ordered pair will be 2 pi over 3, 2 square root 3 pi over 3 minus 3. Again, this would be minus 1, which is the same as negative 3 over 3, as we see here. I hope you found this video helpful. Thank you for watching.